Okay, so now I want to talk, yeah, a bit more about the pure logical view, let's say. Again, the talk is about description logics and again about proofs and the justifications that Christian was also mentioning in the beginning, and in particular about the size of these things. So this is empirical comparison about how large justifications are versus how large corresponding proofs are. So yeah, the main motivation, we already heard that DLs are used in large ontologies, particularly very popular for biomedical ontologies that have like hundreds of thousands of axioms. And then how do you explain a single entailment, even if that is not like surprising, but still you just want to know more about the structure of the ontology, and yeah, you require some explanation of why a certain thing follows from an ontology, even if it's not about amputating fingers and hands. So as I said, we already heard there are two approaches, justifications and proofs. And the justifications are the basic starting point where you can say, okay, these are the axioms in the ontology that that cause this problem, or at least one possibility of causing this entailment. And then proofs can be seen as another step on top, if you want to look at it that way. So you provide the user with additional steps that actually lead to the final conclusion. And so, as I said, the focus of this work was mainly an empirical comparison of these two ways of explaining, and in particular regarding the size, but also some other measures that I will explain later. And this also has a practical relevance for actually computing proofs, because if we find out that actually the size of the justifications predicts the size of the proof, like whenever I have a small justification, then I'm guaranteed to get a small proof. Then what I can do is that I can compute the justification first, which is usually much easier than computing a full proof from a huge ontology. And then from that justification, I can compute the proof. And I'm still guaranteed to have, or more or less guaranteed to have, a, let's say, small proof if we're just talking about size. So, in just to talk again about this in more detail, so we have seen justifications are minimal subsets of the ontology that entail a given consequence. And here we see a view of the ontology editor protege that supports justification computation already since a long time. And you will get, for example, for this one axiom that we had seen in the previous slide, we will, this justification will point out the 5 out of 200,000 axioms that are actually responsible for this consequence. So that's already very useful. And they are usually small, at least definitely small compared to the size of the whole ontology. But sometimes the inferences may not yet be that obvious, as we have also seen in the previous talk. And moreover, we often have several justifications that could prove the same thing. And then we are left to figure out which one would be the best to explain the consequence to the user. Now, for looking at proofs, there's also already an implementation for protege on that, where you have a graphical representation or in a tree view-like thing where you can go through this step by step. So you're starting from the axiom that you want to explain, then you can ask, okay, why does this follow? Okay, because of that one, and that one, and that one. And you can drill down even further if you want to explain certain things more or less like in the interactive presentation we saw previously, just maybe not as fancy. And in the end, you will end up with some nodes in this tree that are just the ontology axioms. So the leaves of this proofs are essentially a justification. So they all have to be grounded in the ontology, of course. And the proofs are obviously larger than just having the justification. So you need to go through all these steps, although you may not have to look at all of the subtrees because you already know some of them are obvious. And the individual proof steps are often easy to grasp because they're just doing very small modifications in the of the premises. And so this can be a better way, or at least an alternative way of explaining that is easier, although larger. So you have to go through more material, of course. And as I said, these proofs contain the justification, its leaves. So in fact, you can, as hinted in the beginning, you can just compute the justification first and then compute a proof from that, which makes it much faster. But again, we have the problem that we have multiple possible proofs, so even more than just justifications. So even if you have, if you fix the justification, you can still have multiple ways of combining these into individual inference steps. And that's where our main research line is going. So we're trying to find out what are the best proofs or yeah, that we want to show to the user. And yeah, a very simple choice here, maybe not the, the best one, but one can just first try to optimize for size, right? So try to find the shortest proof, the smallest proof to explain a certain consequence. And that's where the question of this presentation comes in. So if I want to compute a short proof, is it okay if I first compute a small justification and then look for the smallest proof for that justification? Or would I possibly obtain a smaller proof if I would just have started from a larger justification? And as I said, this is an empirical evaluation, and where we evaluated this on is on the corpus that was already presented in last year's XLOCA workshop by Patrick Koopman, where we built up a corpus of proofs extracted from standard benchmark. And in that paper, we did that because we wanted to compare different ways of computing proofs. But now we had this corpus, and we can also use it here. So now come a few slides from last year to describe the basic setting. And I'm sorry, but they seem to have gotten a bit yellow over the time, but I hope you can still read everything. So this paper considered multiple ways to compute proofs. And the first one is, as we have seen already, by a consequence-based reasoning procedure, in particular the one implemented in ELK, which is the reasoner for EL ontologies, that is based on this rule-based calculus, and quite obviously you can see where the proofs come from. They are generated as part of the reasoning process. So doing reasoning in ELK naturally gives you proofs. And yeah, this is actually the way how it was implemented in Protégé, how this this proof interface that I've shown you previously was obtained. So you just take these rules and instantiate them for your entailment, and then you get a proof. And then there was another approach that we introduced last year, where the idea is that we can use forgetting So we are basically forgetting symbols in each proof step. And the idea is the same as in propositional resolution, where you have two clauses and you pick a literal to resolve on. Essentially, you forget about the literal and you're just considering the rest of the clauses. So P vanishes. And then you have a smaller expression, and then you can try to forget more and more things from that. And in the end, you get your goal clause. I mean, for resolution, this would be the empty clause. For us, it's just another entailment. So just to illustrate this in a small example, so suppose we're trying to prove that A implies B, and we have these three axioms. Then in this case, we can first forget about D because, okay, maybe you already see how this follows. So A implies C, C implies that there exists something that's D and it's connected by R. And if there's something connected by R, then the original element must satisfy B. So this chain, basically it can chain these three together. But as you have noticed, maybe already that this D is not really necessary for that. So I can first try to forget about the D. And what I obtain is just top here, so true. So this axiom is reformulated into saying, okay, C just implies that there exists something connected with R. I don't care about what it is. I just forgot about the D. Now I can also forget about the R. And then what remains is just the consequence that C implies B. So the R has vanished. Now finally I can forget about the C and I get the final conclusion. So in the end, what we get here is a structure that looks very similar to a proof that would be obtained from ELK, let's say, but there's no fixed set of inference rules involved. But at each rule, you just label the step with the symbol that was forgotten. And in this way, yeah, you can see, I mean, this is sound, everything that we derive follows from the premises, and in the end, we obtain our conclusion. So this is an alternative way to get a proof. And in this previous work, this was now compared. And yeah, the most interesting part for us here is this corpus that we obtained. So the previous comparison was, okay, we take the smallest proofs generated by ELK in this calculus. We take forgetting-based proofs that were generated using different forgetting mechanisms, forgetting tools for description logics, for different variants of expressivity. We don't need to go into much detail here. And the corpus was obtained from the our reasoner evaluation, in particular the EL track. So we are focusing on EL ontologies or ELH with role hierarchies. So this is a nice set of ontologies that is used in many experiments. And what we did, I mean, we did use these ontologies to generate proofs in the following way. So we first extracted what we call justification patterns. So all possible entailments of the form A implies B or A is equivalent to B in all of these ontologies. I mean, there are millions of those. But then we looked at the justifications for these entailments and took just the equivalence class of those justifications, modular renaming of symbols. I mean, obviously in many ontologies, the same proofs appear again and again, just instead of ABC, we have DEF. And we didn't really care about this distinction because we just want to know about the size of the resulting proofs and doesn't matter in that setting. What are the names of the symbols that we have there? So we forgot basically everything about whether this was a medical ontology or not. We replaced everything by A's, B's, and C's. And what we ended up with was 1573 patterns of justifications that can prove entailments of this form. So all possible ways that appear, at least in real world ontologies, how such a justification could look like. And then we compared, then we ran our proof generators on these justifications, as I said. So first computing the justifications already took a long time, but since we then had only small justifications, computing the actual proofs was actually quite fast comparatively. And then we compared these proofs in terms of size. So just measured by the number of axioms they have. And also with respect to complexity, where we took a particular measure that was developed also quite a long time ago already, and was trying to measure the cognitive complexity of justifications in particular. So if you are given an entailment in a set of axioms that this entails, how complex is this? And they also did some user studies to validate this, and it seemed that at least there was a correlation between this measure and how well people did on tasks relating to these justifications. Now, this is a measure for justifications. So basically just single sets of axioms, and we just took this and applied this to proofs by viewing each proof step as a justification and then compute the maximum or the average over all the proof steps. So basically how complex is this proof on average in the average step, or what is the maximum complexity of a step in that proof. So now we can get back to the present, and now we know what this corpus looks like, and evaluate our actual question that we had. So as you recall, what we did was we first extracted the justifications and then produced proofs from that and compared the size of the proofs from different tools. But the question that we have now is, would choosing a larger justification instead have allowed us to find an even smaller proof? So could it be, theoretically it's possible that when I allow more axioms in the leaves, that I can find a shorter way to prove the consequence. And yeah, that's what this paper was about. So we compared each of the justification patterns with the proofs that were induced by these justification patterns or produced by our three proof generators. And then we compared, okay, does a small justification mean that the proof is also small, and also compared the complexities. And these are the results, at least on this corpus. So about size, we have three graphs showing the justification size versus the proof size. And you already see a nice correlation here that somehow this increases when you increase the justification size. And there seems to be a line here at a slope of 2, which means that if I have a justification of size 20, then my proof will be of size 40 roughly, which somehow corresponds to a proof where I have just binary rules, right? So if I have two premises, they each produce a conclusion, then I have to basically have as many intermediate steps as I have axioms in my justification. So that's why the size gets blown up by 2. Sometimes we can also get larger proofs. And this is how this looks like from the side. Let's say if I take the histogram of the ratios of the proof size versus the justification size, we see, okay, most of the proofs are of double the size. Some proofs are 4 times the size, and there are course some outliers where we also can nicely compare the different proof generators, but that's maybe not so relevant here. So Lethe computed slightly smaller proofs than Elk. But this is still on the set of 1,500 justification patterns. So what does this mean for the actual ontologies? And this is part of this adjusted histogram. So where we multiplied each of the patterns with the number of times it actually occurred in the real benchmark set. And then we see that basically all of these proofs are clustered around this factor of 2, right? So it's, so what we can conclude is that the size of the proof really strongly depends on the size of the justification, especially after we adjusted for the actual number of occurrences in the real ontologies, but it doesn't explode. So it's really just what you would expect from a back of the envelope calculation. It's just a factor of 2 basically around that. Of course, you can get a bit lower if you have proof rules with 3 premises, but that's basically what's happening. So then here's the comparison of justification complexity. So the complexity of the set of all the leaves of the proof basically versus the average step complexity. And that looks a bit less linear. So there's a bit of a more varied picture, but what we can see in general is that the average complexity is, let's say, around half of the original complexity. So that's also what we would expect, right? So the proof complexity is halved. So the individual proof steps are easier to see than just having the full justification. But some of the proofs, even a significant amount, even after adjusting for the number of occurrences, they have even an average complexity of just the same as the original justification. So if we can identify some of these cases, then for these cases, probably doesn't make much sense to have the proof if it just contains more steps and they are just as complex as the original justification. And finally, we looked at the maximum step complexity. And here we have to conclude that actually this turns out to be more or less the same as the original justification complexity, at least when we adjust. Yeah, I mean, in general, it looks much more colorful, but this histogram speaks a very different language and tells us that, okay, in most proofs, there will be at least one step that is just as complex as the original justification, at least according to that measure. So maybe it's not such a good idea to use proofs. But yeah, we also looked a little bit in these corner cases. So what actually happens in some of these extreme ratios? So here we have a justification that is very small and very low complexity. So we just have a chain of equivalences basically, and the proof that was generated by Elk has to decompose the equivalences first into subsumptions and then try to combine them again back into an equivalence. So obviously this is not a very intelligent proof and can be easily fixed by just introducing separate rules for equivalences, for example. And here we have the opposite example, I would say. So we have a justification that is actually quite large. So the justification you can see here in these leaves, yeah, you have 14 axioms that are of varied shapes. You have some existential restrictions, some have conjunctions, some are just normal inclusions between names, and 14 of them. So just given these 14 axioms, it would be very hard to see the conclusion, which is reflected in the complexity here of 900. But in the proof, you actually have a maximum complexity of 280. And you see that all of these steps are very simple to follow. So that's one example of where this works quite nicely. And the ratio of the size is more or less 2, as I have said, right? Because we have binary rules here in all the cases. So to conclude, what have you found out? So small justifications generally yield small proofs. So that's good, because that means we can just start from a small justification and then compute the proof, which is much faster. And also that the average complexity generally goes down, but unfortunately the maximum complexity, not like in this nice case here, goes down only slightly, if it goes down at all. So you will have maybe a smaller step, but where somehow the complexity of this justification is still concentrated in this one step. In some sense. Okay, and now we are working in a different direction and trying to condense proofs in some way, trying to find a middle ground between having just the justification and this huge detailed proof, or finding a good compromise between too much and too little information there. But this obviously, as has already been observed many times, needs to be tailored to the specific user, for example, what the previous knowledge is about the logic, and of course, more importantly, about the domain that they are supposed to understand. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.